So I'm just going to speak to you for 5 minutes, introducing our People, Ponds and Water project and say a little bit about the background of Freshwater Habitats Trust, and then hand over to Pete to really introduce you to the project properly. I wanted just to say a word or two about Freshwater Habitats Trust to get us started, and something about our history and our aims and what we do. Our mission, we all have mission statements these days, our mission is to protect the biodiversity of freshwater habitats for everyone to enjoy. And that's what we're trying to do, is achieve a vision where we can make a significant and lasting improvement to freshwater biodiversity on the ground. And on the ground is really kind of crucial for us these days. And we've got five main aims, which you can see there, which are to protect and enhance the best freshwater habitats and make sure they retain their value in the long term. We're trying as well to build out from those habitats, to increase their size and functionality. Pretty standard laws and stuff these days, really. We're trying to restore the connectivity of freshwater landscapes and protect the most threatened species and ensure that their populations are actually increasing rather than, as so many are at the moment, decreasing. And we're trying finally to increase the quality of the wider landscape for freshwater species by increasing the area of clean water out there, either by creating habitats or cleaning up existing ones, and make freshwater habitats better functioning naturally. A tiny bit of history. Some of you will know that we were founded in 1988 as Pond Action, but right from the outset our interests covered all kinds of fresh waters, and actually, as long ago as 1991, we had money from WWF to start a freshwater conservation NGO. It just took us 20 years to get around to actually doing it. We began our work in Oxfordshire with a survey of the ponds of Oxfordshire, which we then moved on to a national pond survey in the late 80s and early 1990s. And this picture here is one of our first practical projects on the ground, the Pink Hill Meadow demonstration site, which we created with Thames Water and the Environment Agency to demonstrate the effectiveness, the benefits of clean water pond creation for wildlife. But we were interested in all sorts of things right from the start. So we started the River Restoration Project in 1994 with this demonstration scheme in Oxfordshire, which then went on to the project, then went on to become what's now known as the River Restoration Centre, which some of you I'm sure will still be working with. In 2000, we did an important piece of survey work, which was really the first ever comparison of all kinds of freshwater habitats. We looked at the biodiversity of ponds, rivers, streams, lakes and ditches across our landscape and produced this paper, which has become something of a classic, describing where freshwater biodiversity is found in the landscape, and was the first place where we realised that ponds were as important at a landscape scale as the things we've always taken for granted as being important, rivers and lakes. Around that time we did the first national survey of canal invertebrates. We made the first national description of the biodiversity of all of the UK's landscape for DEFRA in a thing called the Aquatic Ecosystems of the UK Agricultural Landscape Project, which brought together information on ponds and lakes and streams and rivers and ditches, describing the plants and animals in freshwater that lived in these different landscapes. You can see there are 13 different landscape classes across the whole of the country. And around that time as well, with colleagues across Europe, we were instrumental in setting up the European Pond Conservation Network, which has done a lot of work bringing together the science of ponds specifically. But from around the mid-2000s onwards, we became increasingly aware that we had all this information and we were telling people stuff, but it actually wasn't really translating into practice on the ground. We were still seeing freshwater species and habitats declining and diminishing in quality. And so from about 2008, we refocused our entire organisation. We were still called Pond Conservation Trust at that point. We refocused our entire organisation to start acting more directly on the ground. And that finally led us to the transformation of becoming the Freshwater Habitats Trust in September 2013. And from then onwards, we began working at a large scale practically. We began with the Million Ponds Project, which set out to double the number of ponds in the UK over 50 years, particularly by creating clean water ponds, put clean water back in the landscape. And following on from that, we've started People, Ponds and Water, which Pete will talk about in detail in a moment or two when I sit down. Our programme now is concerned with identifying what we call important freshwater areas, bringing together data on species and habitats into a single map and database so we as an organisation, and we hope other people as well, can see where the most important hotspots are for freshwater biodiversity so we can start to protect those properly, ensure their value in the long term, and build out from those places. We, of course, are working at the landscape scale these days, isn't everybody? We're the co-hosts of the New Forest catchment with the National Park Authority there, which is one of the New Forest is one of the finest wetland landscapes in the whole of Western Europe. We've always been an evidence-based organisation, and we're continuing that in quite a big way with our water-friendly farming project, which is looking at how effective land management techniques are for protecting freshwater biodiversity, for controlling flooding, for reducing pollution. We're all doing this kind of stuff these days, but actually the evidence base about its effectiveness is surprisingly scarce and thin on the ground still. And finally, we're working to protect and enhance freshwater biodiversity at this scale by developing what we call, internally at least, the freshwater network, a network of people and places where we're trying to, as I've said a moment ago, protect the best places, ensure their value for the long term, build out from these areas, and link them together with a clean network of clean water habitats, both by creating new clean waters, for example through pond creation work, or by cleaning up existing water bodies which are suffering from pollution impacts. So that's what we're doing as an organisation. I want to hand over now to a very rapid run through the last 20 years of our work, essentially, and our aims. I want to hand over now to Pete, who's the Regional Project Officer for the People, Ponds and Water Project, to talk you through the details of this, our latest, largest practical project, which is supported by the Heritage Lottery Fund. So, over to Pete. Thank you very much.
Hello, good morning. So, I'm going to start by reiterating Jeremy's point about how important ponds are. This is the study that Jeremy mentioned in the paper that he showed, showing that ponds can be disproportionately important for freshwater biodiversity. Not all ponds, but they have the potential to be. We think that ponds support, or it's a fact that ponds support, around two-thirds of all freshwater biodiversity, and it's 10% of those priority species that we all care about. Yet, around 90% of ponds are degraded or impacted upon. And to confound matters and make things worse, ponds are little protected, really, as habitat, and they're not surveyed thoroughly on a landscape and on a national scale. So our vision for the PPW, the People, Ponds and Water Project, is to increase people's, increase people's enjoyment, knowledge and experience of ponds. We want to bring people with us on this project, and we want them to be involved in making a difference on the ground. There are two overarching objectives that we want to set forth in the PPW project. The first is to train many people in participating in activities that help them enjoy freshwater heritage. This could be surveys, it could just be getting out and seeing a really high quality pond. We then want to use the data that's been collected from the project to make a difference nationally. It's a combination of evidence gathering, practical action, and then using that information to make a difference. So, PPW has three components, and I'm going to talk about them in depth today in my half an hour slot. So first up is PondNet. This is much more than just a national pond survey. This is setting up a freshwater network. So it's a series of sites nationally where we can collect really important data about ponds and uncommon freshwater species of used ponds. We then have flagship ponds, which is 70 or so of the most important freshwater sites for biodiversity in England and Wales. We want to be supporting those sites in the long term and helping land managers, helping managers of those sites, to manage them in the most effective ways. We then have Clean Water for Wildlife, which is a mass participation citizen science project where everybody can get involved in learning about nutrient enrichment, and finding out about which areas of the freshwater landscape are impacted upon by nutrients and which areas are clean. So it's essential to the work that Jeremy set out and our vision going forward. So on such an ambitious project like that, a national project like that, we've instated four regional project officers, which I am one. That's overseen from our head office by a project coordinator and project administrator. And to make a project manageable within the office's areas, we're rolling this out over the course of the three-year project. So we started in the 2015 counties there, and moving, and gradually by 2017, we'll be rolling this project out into Suffolk, Norfolk, Essex and Cambridge. So the first area I want to talk about is ConNet, which is a national freshwater network. So the background to ConNet. It's a national volunteer survey network, and it's to generate statistically robust data on ponds nationally. It's a habitat-based survey, although we're obviously also looking at the quality of ponds and the species that use them as well. And this project has been developed through extensive trials with DEFRA in Natural England. So it's been a three-year process coming to the point where we went to Heritage Lottery and they very kindly have given us the money to take this whole thing forward. It uses three significant measurements. The first of all is an overall pond quality for England and Wales. The second, the quality of a series of priority ponds, which Jeremy mentioned, the National Pond Survey, so it's revisiting those sites. And then thirdly, the status of a subset of threatened pond species. So we're going to be revisiting records of around 30 critical species ponds. There are, of course, other pond surveys, National Pond Surveys we mentioned, looking at high quality ponds. The Countryside Survey, which looks at water chemistry and plants in ponds and estimates the number in the landscape. But that's an infrequent survey, it only happens every 8 to 10 years. And then there's species-focused surveys as well, such as the National Amphibian and Reptile Recording Scheme that the Ark Trust run. All those are really valid, but they don't necessarily give us the sort of information that we can use to create robust statistical data. So PondNet uses a series of overlapping networks. We have an amphibian network that uses 100 1-kilometre grid squares to survey for toad and 200 to survey for great-crested newt. We then have these 30 priority pond species, called Section 41 species now, and we're looking to survey 50 ponds nationally for each of those species. We then have around 100 ponds nationally where we're going to be undertaking SIM surveys looking at pond quality, so that will be investigating plants and invertebrates in ponds. We'd also like to survey for dragonflies as well, although they didn't tell us quite so much about pond quality, but they're a really interesting thing to learn about. And then there are self-selected sites that people can put and add to our network as we improve them. So we've tried to make this project as inclusive as possible. We want to give a range of different skill levels for people to enjoy, so a range of different survey levels. First of all, there's pond habitat surveys that anybody can get involved in, toad surveys, and eDNA, which is a new way of detecting great crested newts, or rare plants. They don't necessarily require any prior experience. We then have another tier of surveys, which are for people perhaps who've had a bit more experience or would like to come and undertake some training with us. They're for full amphibian surveys for great crested newts, surveys of wetland plants and invertebrates, and for dragonflies. So we're using a series of randomly selected ponds across the landscape. They genuinely are random. We're coming across some really beautiful ponds, such as this Herefordshire pond with pilwort in it, beautiful. We're coming across some quite awful ponds that are covered in crassula, you're probably all familiar with that. And we're coming across some quite frankly bizarre ponds, which is the one at the end there in Cambridge. I won't name and shame where exactly that was. The first critical thing we want volunteers to help us with is collecting habitat data about ponds. So this is a habitat recording form, and we're asking people to go to the site that's been randomly selected and give us information about the physical attributes of the pond, some information about whether fish and waterfowl are present, and surrounding landscape use. There's also space on that form to complete data about water chemistry as well, which is really important for this. There's the next entry-level survey, which is toad survey. People just going, volunteers going to the pond, all ponds in the 1 kilometre grid square, and looking for the presence of toad spawn or frog spawn, and we'd like volunteers to record that on their sheet. Really, really straightforward. Anybody can get involved in that, and we're also asking volunteers to record adults, immature and tadpoles as well. The more complicated side, which is the Great Crested Newts survey network. This is 200 1-kilometre grid squares across England and Wales. 200 is the magic number. That will give us the data necessary to talk about changes to Great Crested Newt populations, which is really important. We're visiting 50% of squares that have previous records of Great Crested Newts. 50% that have no records for great crested newts. That's really important too. There are 200 squares, 180 in England and 20 in Wales, and that equates to roughly 3 ponds per square. You can see on the map there, this is my project area, the red dots there are eDNA, We were very fortunate last year in 2015, Natural England funded 100 of those 1 kilometre grid squares to be surveyed using eDNA technology, which I'll talk a little bit about in a minute as one of the survey options. So, the design for Great Coastal Deep Surveying has been made compatible with NARS, the Amphibian and Reptile Trust, long-standing Newt survey. So we wanted to make our survey design for PondNet comparable with the data that was being collected and complementary to the survey that was already going on. So only PondNet, only our project, uses the number of occupied 1 kilometre grid squares for Great Coastal Deep. Both PondNet and NARS use the southwest pond, so number 2 marked on that map, to detect presence of Great Coastal Deep. Only PondNet uses the number of occupied ponds per grid square. So we're interested in how many of those ponds in the square are occupied by Great Coastal Deep. That's what's going to give us the really detailed information about Great Coastal Deep and how they're faring in England and Wales. And only NARS, only the Amphibian and Reptile Conservation Trust survey, will gather information about the amount of mutes per pond. We're not necessarily interested in that, we just want to know presence or absence. So in order for volunteers to undertake this work, we're providing training in the core counties we're working in. So we can develop volunteer ID skills, we can issue volunteers with the license to undertake those surveys and train them in habitat recording. Volunteers go to Great Coastal Deep squares in April to June, and they survey all the ponds in the 1 kilometre grid square using a method using torch light surveys or egg searches, and they do up to 4 visits to detect presence absence. After the 4th visit, if there's no newts, then we say that there's no newts found, we say that the square is unoccupied. eDNA is a new survey technique which we've been fortunate to be involved in developing. And that offers an alternative to the traditional surveys of water trapping, torching at night, egg searching or netting. eDNA is a very, very straightforward method of collecting a water sample, which is then analysed in the lab, and new DNA is then extracted from that sample, and it's a 99.3% accuracy for detection. And you can see Adrian there very kindly helping us out last year at Blackford Lakes, which is one of our 1 kilometre grid squares that we surveyed. So then the results for pond occupancy from the eDNA work we did last year, we've worked out that 13% of ponds were occupied by Great Coastal Deep, which is broadly comparable to the best guesses so far. So the estimates that have been made in 93 and 2013 were for 11 and 12%, and our survey is confirming that around 13% of ponds were occupied by Great Coastal Deep. Also, Of the end data set that we're using to sort of behind this project, 4% of squares on that data set had records of Great Coastal Deep. We found that 34% returned a positive result of the 50 squares that we visited. So 26% of 1 kilometre grid squares we found in the 2015 survey were occupied by Great Coastal Deep. And overall, that's just 26%. So final thoughts on eDNA. We're finding Great Coastal Deep in squares that currently had no records. So it's a great detection method. Ponds are probably difficult to survey. We've had just one false negative so far in the project, and that was for a pond that was heavily turbid. So someone went to the pond, did their eDNA survey, and it returned a negative result. Yet they saw a Great Coastal Deep when they were doing the survey, but we think that was because the pond water was so very turbid. We had no false positives during the trials for this in 2015. Great Coastal Deep been confirmed that really hard to survey ponds, and we've actually observed some genuine losses from ponds. So sites where we knew Great Coastal Deep had previously been present, and eDNA hadn't picked them up. The next survey network is for pond quality, and this is just 150 sites nationally. We're surveying for all wetland plants and invertebrates to family, follows the SIM methodology. I'm also recording habitat data. This will provide us with a basis for really important data that will then tell us about how ponds are changing. So pond quality surveys use SIM methodology, which is a repeatable survey for pond quality. It combines wetland plants and invertebrate families and gives an overall score, and it scores a pond against a known set of unimpaired ponds. We're providing sampling methodology training, so we're inviting people with existing skills in plant and invertebrate identification to come out and join us on courses where we'll be showing about the methodology and how we survey those ponds. We really like the skilled volunteers to help us out in that survey when we rolled this out in Suffolk, Norfolk in 2017. We then have a restricted species network, the overview of which you can see here. This is for 30 bat or priority pond species. We're looking to survey 50 species nationally. We're revisiting records in the last 25 years for these species. And most of these surveys can be undertaken at entry level, so by anyone, any volunteer that would like to get involved. We are offering some training on this. We have an agreed methodology in place for each of these 30 species, and that's been developed with other conservation organisations and specialists who are already surveying. So some of them are displayed below there, and I've got a full list of the 30 on the stand at the back there. And to measure change in time, which is really what PondNet is all about, we're looking at the number of continually occupied ponds at national level for these species. We want to know about the change in abundance at each pond, and we want to know about the strength of the population. So we want to know whether these key species are in ponds adjacent to the pond that the record is from. So just to give a quick example then, one of the species of interest, pond mud snail, this is found in low nutrient ponds, so high quality ponds, not as the name suggests. It's very happy in temporary ponds. It's got a really unique way of burrowing down into the soft earth to survive the times when the ponds dry out. Very, very scattered distribution across England and Wales. And we're offering training to volunteers here, and this is some photographs from a session right in Herefordshire, teaching people how to come and survey for this snail. It's actually quite simple, although there are some that look similar to it. Once you get your eye in and you learn how to survey for this species, it's actually quite straightforward to get going. So we're looking at the abundance, we're looking at the number of snails. It's a 1 minute in the water search time, and then you search surrounding ponds as well, and give us some habitat data as well, which is also really, really important. Pillwort, which is another of the 30 species of concern that we're surveying for, in the 30 section 41 species. Again, a very scattered distribution. The UK is nationally important for pillwort. It's a stronghold, if you like, given it's declining so much. And for pillwort, we're asking volunteers to give us a measurement of area cover. So we want people to record whereabouts in the pond they're seeing this. So again, we can revisit that in years to come and track how that's changing. And also for that habitat data as well. In order for us to work with these restricted species, we've developed a relationship with the local record centres across England, with help from Natural England, some funding from Natural England to do that. And they've been providing us with really detailed records of the restricted species. They've also been verifying sites for us and making sure that the site that the record is from is actually a pond, for some of these species cross over slightly. They've been assisting with getting land owner permissions for allowing volunteers access to survey. And they've been advertising the surveys to the recording community, and there's an example of one there. We've also been attending training so they can learn methodology that we are putting in place, and then hopefully they can pass that on in years to come to other recorders. All of this information on that we stored centrally on what's called the WaterNet portal. So volunteers will be able to log in to the page, they'll be able to upload their information, they'll be able to upload pictures and keep track of the surveys they've been doing. This data is going to be free for everybody to take. It's not something that we're taking just for ourselves, this is freely available open access data, and it will be also shared with NBN as well, and also local record centres, of course. So that's PondNet. The second part of the PPW project, Flagship Ponds, is about protecting 70 of the best wetland sites and preventing, hopefully, the deterioration of those sites in the long term. And you can see that in East Anglia there's a great concentration of flagship sites. We've split this into two groups. So for 2015, we've been working in the West Main and in the central area, so on those sites around Oxfordshire there in Shropshire. I'm just about to start this project up in East Anglia. So I'm really looking forward to seeing some of these fabulous sites you've got over here in Suffolk and then up in Norfolk. So two of the key ones that many folk in Shortland Room know about, Alton Marshes and then Redgrave and Lochmer Fen, two of our flagship pond sites we look forward to working on. Now instead of me trying to tell you about how great those sites are, having never visited them myself, I thought I'd give some examples instead of some of the general activities that we might look to do on flagship sites. So the really critical outcome is that all those sites are protected in the long term and sustained in the long term. We'd like to work with site managers to put in place a management plan specifically for the freshwater elements on the site. We'd like regular monitoring of key species and pond quality. And we'd like to help where needed to support funding, support management and habitat creation with the funding that we have. We'd also like to put in place an early warning system, and that may use volunteers and people with eyes on the ground checking out some of these very, very important species that the site supports. So it's awareness at a local and regional level. We'll be using our social media, our website and our presence to talk more broadly about these sites. A couple of examples then, what we've been working on so far. This is Boughton Pits in Peterborough. It's a legacy of Peterborough's industrial past, and it's a site with somewhere between 300 and 400 ponds on it. It's internationally important for Great Coastal News. But we're not just interested in the news, we're also interested in the child connaissance here, which is the picture above. So that's the lesser bearded stoneworts. And we're helping the managers of that site, Frog Life, survey a network of those ponds on that site to monitor how that really, really critical species is doing on the site. We're also providing them with equipment and training as well. Second example I'll give just briefly is Cock Marsh in Berkshire, which is a series of ponds on the River Thames floodplain. These are managed by the National Trust, and they're home to one of the rarest plants, whereas pond plants, wetland plants in England, the Cypress fuscus brown galangale. So we're working with site managers there to undertake a full survey of all the ponds, because believe it or not, even though this site is so important, there's actually very little information about the four ponds. And we're going to be training wardens on site to help them learn more about the important plants there and then reiterate that information back to visitors to the site. We're also working with a local photographer on this site as well to capture what's going on and hopefully get some historic photographs of these ancient ponds and the plants and grazing and things that are associated with them. It's about building a story and telling a picture as much as anything else. The final part of the PPW project, which I'll cover just briefly, is Clean Water for Wildlife. This is a mass participation citizen science project where we're arming the general public, volunteers, with kits to detect nutrient pollution, so phosphate and nitrate. Nutrient enrichment often doesn't seem real. It's a great big problem for fresh waters, as I'm sure most people here know, but it's invisible. People can't see it. So these kits we've got, and I'm going to be demonstrating some of these on our stand at the lunch break, make that nutrient enrichment visible. People can see the colour develop and they can see how enriched their fresh waters are. So it's collecting important information on different water body types. 95% of water bodies are unmonitored. We do a great job of monitoring rivers and streams, but very little work goes into monitoring ponds, for example, and other smaller water bodies. Putting science into people's hands. So we're enabling anybody to go and gather really important information about the status of fresh waters. We're providing an entry-level activity that anybody can get involved in. This is a peer-reviewed project, so don't just take my word for it. We've got a document about to go online which will tell you about how we've come to the conclusions we have and how we've done lab tests to make sure that these kits give a representative result compared to full surveys. They would never replace full surveys, but they're a very good quick indication of identifying nutrient enrichment, and hopefully identifying the freshwater places as well that still exist so we can build out from them. We've done a couple of different projects around this so far. This is an example on a small scale, where we brought a group of people along to a nature reserve to monitor the same nature reserve that Jeremy showed in those first slides. To monitor all the ponds on the site for nutrient enrichment. And the blue colour there indicates great, high, clean quality water. The green is good, which is fantastic. The red, sadly, is the lower end of that, so highly enriched sites. And these are the reasons there for phosphate on that site. And it's probably no surprise to see the River Thames there, unfortunately, red and high in phosphate. So you can apply for these kits, you can sign up with me today, and you can go out and you can test any water body you like for phosphate and nitrate, and we're providing instructions with some interpretation as well to how to do the kits and what that result really means. And we'd love to have those results back to add to our data set. all we need is just a good reference from where you sample. It can be any water body type, not just ponds. The other end of the scale to that is a much broader project where we 330 sample points across Greater London. This was conducted in winter 2015. We did nitrate and phosphate tests on ditches, rivers, streams, ponds and lakes, equal numbers of each, all the way across Greater London. And the results are telling. Only a very, very small proportion of those 330 water bodies sampled were clean. And I think the results speak for themselves, that the ponds come out highest on that. So 26 of those ponds were clean and of zero concentration. And I'll finish just with a little picture here of that. The freshest, the cleanest pond that we saw in London during that survey. No surrounding housing estate, nicely buffered, no public access. So it's a nice and clean site there with zero nitrate and zero phosphate. We're working to make sure that the site managers for that site know how important that is in the context of Greater London. So finally, it's a big thanks to all the people that have helped us this year so far. Some of those people are in this room today. Thank you very much for helping us. We've had an exceptional response on net so far, BPW. We've actually doubled the target of ponds to be surveyed. So we've really hit the ground running, and hopefully we'll continue that success as we move into the next batch of counties. So we really look forward to launching in Suffolk and East Anglia as we move forward into 2017. Thank you very much.